Hello, good afternoon, everyone. I am Harshita Singhal from DSCI. I am a technical consultant. I would like to extend a very warm welcome to all of you to the 16th edition of NASSCOM DSCI Annual Information Security Summit. Thank you for joining this session with title Bearing the Weight of Digital Security. With that, now I would like to welcome our panelists for this session. So first, I would like to welcome Ms. Sushmita Sankaran. She is Associate Director, Head of IDEM Practice, Happiest Mind Technology. She will be the moderator of this session. Welcome, Ms. Sushmita. The next panelist will be Mr. Dipesh Jain. He is Chief Manager, IT, Power Finance Corporation. Next, we will have Ms. Yogini Sahani, Vice President, JP Morgan Chase. The fourth panelist will be Mr. Sandeep Kamble. He is founder and CTO Secure Layer 7. And finally, we will have Ms. Pooja Agrawal. She is Head Identity and Access Management, NXP Semiconductor. Thank you so much, panelists, for coming to this session. So now I would like to hand over it to Ms. Sushmita for heading this session. Thank you.
Thank you, Harshita. Thank you, everyone, for joining today's session. What we are going to do today is we are going to deliberate on how identity and access management forms the very crux of the overall digital or enterprise digital security, right? And for the uninitiated, now what exactly is the identity and access management? Identity and access management, very simply put, is a framework of policies and technologies to ensure that the right set of people get access to the right set of targets for the defined duration of time with the proper authorization, so on and so forth, right? Now, this was quite uncomplicated a few years back when we had our traditional landscape of the enterprises. The way the landscape of the enterprises has changed, the IAM has also evolved, and that's how we will go into the next set of conversation. But what it typically means is the users, which was tied up to the employees, non-employees, it has gone from human identities to non-human identities. We talk about bots, we talk about machine identities, then we talk about consumers. It's not just related to enterprise users. The devices we talk about is not just the endpoint devices or the target devices. We talk about, not just enterprise owned, we talk about BYODs, CYODs, we talk about targets such as cloud workloads, the devices in your IoT, OT space, right? So deliberate further on this in terms of how the IAM landscape overall has evolved. Let me, call upon the esteemed panel, Mr. Sandeep, who is also the CTO at Secure Layer. So Sandeep, in your immense expertise over the IAM space, how have you seen the traditional IAM landscape evolve over the period of time?
Okay, I think that's great to discuss about the evaluation of the complete IAM over the traditional. So let me start with this digital transformation. As you know that the COVID is helping everyone to accelerate the digital transformation, and eventually that's resulting in the organization moving to the cloud. And that's clearly give us an indication that most of the organization are adopting the microservices architecture, thinking about the remote cultures, bringing more cloud assets, and eventually, like you already mentioned, BOID, IoT devices, and a lot of other assets, which is bringing as a liability to the industry, right? And because of this, I would say the threats continue to be expand, and the use cases for the IAM. And this is where the IAM is helping us to segregate all of this authentication or authorization, or eventually the access control, right? And when we look at the attacks which is happening, and I would say the most advanced attacks happens nowadays, the organization must embrace the convergence of identity proofing, authentication, and the along with the fraud detection. So previously, I think I used to see most of the identity access management that doesn't consider the fraud detection, but now I think we should consider about the fraud detection within the identity management itself. Okay, so going back to the one step, let's talk about the remote working, right? So now everyone is accessing their devices from their home, maybe from some of the cafes they are working, So these networks are unsecured, or I would say the private networks, and eventually they are accessing the enterprise data, right? And we don't know how many devices are there. There might be some of the iPads, iPhone, or any other things, right? So these are the managed devices. So as a enterprise, I should know about it, and I should restrict in the IAM itself. And this is where I will able to figure out what is happening on overall security posture, right? So looking at the threats, we divide into two multiple threats. One is an inside threat, and we also call it as an outside threat. But when it comes to the IAM, I think we should not think about the inside means trusted and outside means untrusted, right? It has been broken for a long time. And I think we should look at all the devices as a one eventually, and we should bring the security gravity to the outside of the enterprises so that we can assess all of the devices eventually, and to make ensure all of the devices having all sort of IAM controls has been placed. Okay. And going back to the devices, right, or assets, nowadays it's not really backed into the assets. It's now been actually used in the APIs or HTTPS. Let's say one of the example, enforcing the IAM policy for a CI/CD pipeline or API gateways, or the cloud or mobile applications. And throughout your contextual IAM strategy that you need to implement eventually to get into the new, or I would say the perfect way of implementing the IAM. This is what I feel, Sushmita.
Thank you, Sandeep. While we spoke about how the IAM landscape in itself has proliferated in terms of Sandeep spoke about DevOps, he spoke about the CI/CD pipeline and the exponential threat landscape, what are your views in terms of trying to address all of these new set of complexities with the digital landscape of the enterprises with a traditional IAM, say your identity management, access management, governance, with a traditional set of controls? How do you see that gaps coming up, and what are your thoughts on those?
Thank you, Sushmita. See, when we talk about identity and access management, it's basically we're talking about the interface of the entire human channel and the technology. And when we want to secure through technology, we have to secure through human interface, and where this identity and access management comes into place, because ultimately, credentials are the digital keys to any company, and I will call it a kingdom. So if we can secure the credentials, if we can have the complete control over the identity, access, and the privileges which we are going to give to any particular user or the equipment, then only we can actually have the complete security coverage over the thing. So now what I saw in the past, that the traditional IAM tools were basically relying on the passwords, credentials only. And if the passwords are compromised, everything is get into, unsecure means of hacking, and it can be hacked, and the cyber attackers can actually play their part. But when we talk about machine learning based contextual IAM tools, then it's not only password based, it's actually we are seeking the contextual information based on their location, their behavior, their access, their everything. And then even if the password is compromised, the system automatically identifies that this is a suspicious behavior and will have an additional layer of access to secure the entire security solution. So that is where we need to work on, and we have to have a machine learning based contextual access mechanism on our entire security landscape through the ML based IAM tools. Secondly, what I have seen, is the earlier there was a centralized dependence on a single, say, AD server or a repository for user validation. But if that particular server, that validating server, goes for a toss for some attack or some downtime, then the entire security solution, the entire servers need a lot of downtime, having large RTOs to recover from that thing. So we need to have a distributed access management system, either through distributed servers or through cloud services, where there is a redundancy of these validation servers and IAM tools. So that's the two basic things which I want to, you know, see in upcoming landscape in my company also, and the industry as at large. Thank you.
Thanks, Deepesh. So Pooja, Deepesh briefly touched upon, you know, passwordless authentication, etc. So authentication forming the very cornerstone of the IAM piece of security, right? What are your thoughts on how authentication in itself has evolved as we speak?
Thanks, Sushmita. And yeah, I think very relevant question, because while technology has evolved so much, but we are still using user ID and passwords to authenticate.
Point. Right?
And then I think passwords, if I go back why passwords are still used, it was started around 60 years back when we had probably issue with the time sharing system where we had to authenticate between a client and a server. And in order to safeguard your files, you better have a password stored in the server. Now it's important to understand that passwords are stored in the servers, not with you. And with the privacy clause coming in our way right now, it's so important that we move away from passwords, right? Because what's there in the server can be easily hacked. In fact, I know that an 8-digit password can be cracked in a second, right? And definitely the evolving technology, passwords are not the best way to manage, or it's costly. It does require complexity. It does require a history, because you have to remember the history. It's not the right solution for us. So what we need to do is we need to also take in consideration of various devices which we have. And then Sandeep spoke about a lot about it. But I think in authentication, we can take advantage of these devices the user has. Right? And why not we look at storing our credentials or maybe the biometrics, maybe the keys in our devices, and use our devices to authenticate first. I think that's what is passwordless these days, right? And with your multiple devices coming into your picture, a user has maybe two or three devices in his home. It's easier to navigate through biometrics or key-based authentication, or maybe even a PIN to unlock your key from your device, secure PPM chip, right? So that's what I think we should probably move on to. Also, I recently heard, I think last year, there was a big incident where we know that MFA, the multi-factor authentication, which is adding complexity to your authentication, could also be hacked. And then the tokens coming from your MFA could be also stolen. I would strongly recommend that we look at technology like FIDO2, right, which also secures or authenticate the source from where the information is coming, right? So if you are using biometrics and other ways to authenticate, please make sure you're compliant with FIDO2 guidelines. And talking about MFA, of course, it does add a defensive layer. So if your critical assets need to be protected, do that with an MFA. Also, one point I would like to add is with Sandeep said context, right? Earlier, we were just doing authentication once and let the user have a full day session running, or maybe multiple day session running. But is that good enough now? No, we need to probably look at context at times of authentication, also in a continuous basis, and then arrive at a decision whether to let the user in or not. I think identity could prevent fraud. So I think this context will help us prevent fraud in a very large extent if we start storing the risk for the user. So that's what I was thinking about, Sushmita.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Pooja, for your wonderful insights. The next I would want to direct the question to Yogini. So Yogini, you come from a BFSI background, right? So what do you think the digital identity's role has been in safe payments? Like, what are the trends and what are those that are adopted within your segment?
Sure. So Thanks, Sushmita. And payments, obviously, money, which is very close to our hearts and which is right next to the reputation, I would say. Very, very important. And before I go there, let me just ask something here, right? Like, say your friend has come to your place and she deals with the Tupperware products. You just select a good lunchbox, pay her cash, and you are done. Now, versus that, you browse through a website where you like your products and the payment option is only digital, or you are asked to transfer money to some unknown number. You have no data about the identity of that entity. That's where it gets tricky. Identity fundamentally remains the same. So what changes when we add the word digital to it? Digital identity can be confirmed when entity possesses one or more valid authenticators that can establish unique identity, which the entity claims. So coming to safety in digital payments that you mentioned, right? Unlike physical identity, say where you can walk into a bank and most transactions were tangible, we had that conventional trust. Digital has made things perimeterless. There is no boundary. And my panelists who spoke prior to me, they have touched upon it briefly. So governance around digital identity is very critical. How is it a game changer, you might ask, and what are the challenges? So I think digitization of payments was happening in pockets. However, it exploded with demonetization. We saw typical traditional cash markets, small payments, volumes rose exponentially for digital payments. Again, no talk is complete till we mention COVID. So in particular, in these pandemic times, there was a dramatic rise in the payments. And if I can take the liberty to say this, it became the need of the hour. Digital payments had not seen any tech-savvy people adopting digital payments, but most senior citizens who stayed away from this because it was not tangible, they couldn't understand how it works. They were not left with much of a choice. My own father, who was not comfortable till he updated his passbook, the hard one, leave alone doing the digital payment, he shifted his loyalty as well. And you know, as per the data shared by RBI for the year ending March 2021, digital payments have recorded a growth of little over 30%. Now, coming back to the safety of the digital payments, right? Identity frauds continue to rise. Users struggle to remember passwords. I think Pooja just mentioned we have multiple devices in our house and you know, we transact from any one of those. Protecting these mobile devices and legality involved in this case of fraud, still very, very complex. Now, needless to say, digital identity has to be protected, very, very crucial for digital payments. I think the most common challenge around digital security, Sushmita, is though the penetration of these mobile devices has risen exponentially, user awareness needs to happen and underlying payment infrastructure has to catch up. Fraud detection engines are in place. However, low value but high volume frauds go unactioned as the economic aggregation is still catching up. To sum it up, I would like to share a few key takeaways to ensure that we protect our digital identity, thereby resulting in safe digital payments. We just heard Pooja saying multi-factor authentication is between safe and not very safe, but I believe that they still believe it's one of the simplest one to continue to implement. You can add a context-based MFA and it becomes very powerful for our security. The payment solutions firm, they need to ensure that they have a robust underlying infrastructure which is immune to identity spoofing. Lastly, since it's a matter of payment, I think we should strive to strike a perfect balance which gives you seamless user experience. Like keep it really simple for the user, but at the same time, provide that assurance, your digital identity is secure. Thank you.
Fair enough. Thank you, Yogini. So would it be fair or would it be safe to assume that identity would form the very crux of the overall cybersecurity posture for an organization?
Okay. So I wouldn't limit it to identity. I would say the discipline of identity and access management will form the crux of cybersecurity. And like we know, it has three components, identity, authentication, and authorization. So I think zero trust is something which we have been hearing about and it hinges on digital identity. Identity and access management, it enables us to have a view on who has access to sensitive data, how the privileged accounts are handled. Strong controls are required to ensure that identity is protected. because once it is compromised, bad actors can gain entry to your network and they travels laterally. We did speak about the insider threat and the external bad actors. Yes. So various industry reports also state that identity-based attacks are continuously on the rise. Now, they could be for financial reasons, they want to directly steal your money, or say for employment reasons, where they want to pose as you and get a job. It could be anything. So yeah, this discipline is very, very important, especially when users are accessing resources on-prem, on cloud, and they're doing it all the time. So establishing strong identity and access management controls is very, very crucial, and I would say it can serve as starting point for cybersecurity. Thanks.
Thank you, Yogini. So Sandeep, Yogini briefly touched upon zero trust. What are your thoughts on an identity-centric zero trust?
Yeah, I think basically I just want to start with the what is zero trust for people, right? Let me explain in a classic way. When someone says spicy food, it means different thing for different folks, right? That's a perfect example of what spicy somebody is not really spicy to anyone, right? So this is how I feel we should correlate to the zero trust first of all. And when we say zero trust, it is an architecture or an ecosystem helping you to protect the data endpoints eventually. So definitely we can use zero trust in IAM to protect the data endpoints, to protect the data eventually. And the primarily we need to implement the access control over the data endpoints or the devices, which we just spoke, like Pooja just mentioned, or Yogini and the other rest of the folks has been mentioning, right? So let's say if you follow zero trust architecture, everything else, system can defend themselves. Systems are protected, and you can get access to the things which you are able to get the access. Or I would say you can talk to the people who are really your privileged to talk, right? So this is how I would say the zero trust is getting integrated in the IAM itself. And ultimately what we are trying to do is protecting the endpoints and the crawl jewels in our private data centers, or where our data is sitting across the multi-cloud infrastructure. Like people are using a GCP, AWS. There are a lot of cloud service providers are available and our data is sitting there. And this is where we got to secure all of this, right? We got to secure all of this. And before even that, we need to think about creating a proper strategy for a zero trust for your IAM, basically, before even purchasing any sort of technology. So building a strategy would be the first step, I would say. And I can give you one of the example, like we were talking about MFA. So that means we are adding a friction to the authentication. So if I'm an Uber user and if you add me OTP friction, then I would say let's try Nola, right? Or I would say if I'm trying some sort of accessing application and suddenly it's not really giving a proper responses, then I would just exit it, right? So I would say we need to have frictionless, and to have a frictionless, we might need to implement the adaptive authentication process, right? And that adaptive authentication process has to come through the risk score signals, and that risk score signals will be created. I mean, how you will create the risk score? So based on what we discussed, contextual security, where we understand the user behavior, within the user behavior, how the user were accessing the application, or when he was able to log in, what is his peak time to log in, when he never logs in, something similar. Maybe a next one would be the fast geolocation. Suddenly you're authenticated from India, and then eventually you will see someone logged in from the Japan. So these are the parameters or signals we need to consider for adaptive authentication. And this is where you will able to increase the friction for a 2% of fraudster or the 2% of the cyber criminal, where we are going to stop instead of giving a lot of friction to the 98% of the user, right? And this is what I feel we should be implementing, especially zero trust in IAM strategy. And second point I just want to mention here, maybe a lot of organization is not doing this, but I feel there are a lot of accounts which never get disabled even if the employee leave the company, right? This I feel and this I saw. And in my company, I specifically mentioned everyone, once employee exit, we need to call a API And that, again, I'm talking about a microservices architecture, right? So here also I need to have IAM, and this is where we will be able to disable the former employees automatically. And once we disable that, we also need to monitor and audit the privileged users' activity, right? That's really important. If some incidents happens, you know, like, I mean, there are a lot of breaches happen. I don't know who would be the next, but we should have proper monitoring and auditing processes so that we can figure out what happened or what are the things which has happened after the breach or before the breach. This is what I feel so far. So,
Shunda.
Thanks, Sandeep.
Satish, while Sandeep briefly touched upon a few best practices that needs to be done in terms of, he spoke about monitoring and auditing. He also spoke about having robust IAM strategy before we go into an IAM implementation. What are the best practices do you think are pertinent to have to ensure that you have a proper IAM solution rollout? Because we have seen a lot of organization trying to embark on the journey, but not getting quite there. So what are your thoughts on that?
Okay, so as I mentioned earlier, apart from machine learning based access and distributed repository of validation, I will add to the good practice of having an automated identity governance management, because now the users and the solutions are so much expanding, they're ever expanding with a collection of so many passwords, roles, jobs, assignments. It is very much difficult for any human person or human team to manage all those kind of access privileges on a regular basis. So the need of the hour is to have an automated identity governance, because that will actually help in providing the secure posture to the pain areas of IAM, like the administrative access abuse. If the administrators comes up to abusing the system, then there are very limited things one can do. So there have to have a solution which can actually prohibit the administrators to abuse the system. And for that, we need a privileged allegation and delegation management sort of technology, which can actually stop the administrator himself for doing any malware deployment or exploitation by simply observing his behavior, his train of activities, which may harm the entire security systems. That is one. And secondly, this automated identity governance should automatically review periodically all the access rights and the privileges, and also consolidate that if any particular user has a what we call a toxic combination of privileges, knowingly or unknowingly. So this solution should actually make out that no, this user has actually got the right of, for example, say database also and the application also. So the zero trust principle of need to know and those principles are not bypassed by any chance. So this automated governance is the need of the hour, and this can actually, you know, upgrade and enhance the entire security posture.
Thank you, Dipesh. Pooja, Dipesh spoke a little about, you know, the best practices that needs to be done. He spoke about automated identity and access governance, very importantly, SOD enforcements to avoid any toxic combinations while providing accesses, right? Now let's get into a little bit of juicy part of it. What are those common mistakes that organization tend to commit while going on an IAM adoption journey?
And I can probably answer that a lot, because I have implemented and done those mistakes myself, right? So I think many points I would like to share. I'll keep it very brief. Most important thing is to understand that IAM programs are very costly from a regular application development program. So if you make mistakes, those are going to be costly mistakes. And believe me, your stakeholders and your sponsors will not like you if you do that. So I have gone through that journey myself. I think earlier in probably if I see go back 10 years, the major struggle was not having a roadmap, not running IAM as a program, right? I think people were running that in projects in silos, and that was never successful. I think this was 10 years ago. At least I'm very comfortable saying that wherever I go now, I see a strategy, I see a roadmap, I see that there is a stakeholder involvement right from top down way to get IAM in their in the culture and in the mindset of people. So I think this problem is less now. So what's the problem now? I think automation is very key. So people want to automate IAM because it's very costly affair right now, because there are thousands of users, thousands of devices, and you need to create accounts really fast. So people are automating. But what they forget is the bad process. Because if a process is bad and you automate, that still is going to be bad. So I think before you automate technology, please fix your processes first. That is first guidance, because bad processes, if automated, will create a lot of chaos in your system. Second is, I think Sandeep was saying that people don't deprovision, people don't take out accounts. So when you talk about IAM, people think that IAM is to create only accounts and only do provisioning. And they don't have deprovisioning workflows at all. Right. And that worries me. The only deprovisioning workflow probably somebody will implement is at exit. So if somebody leaves, maybe get the account deleted. But what about transfers? What about conversions? Maybe a contractor is becoming an employee. Right? Are we taking care of those rules? Nobody talks about privilege admins access has been taken away rather than it just gets accumulated. Right? So that's a major problem. So you have to discuss your deprovisioning rules ahead of time before you start provisioning. Also, a lot of these IAM tools are on-premise and they are heavily customized. I have seen that because of this customization, the 80, if you do customization 20% in an IAM tool, the 80% of the out-of-box functionality is ruined. You struggle implementing that solution. So please don't customize your IAM solutions. Leverage what you have and then give exceptions to what you don't have. So that's fine. But first fix what you have. What I've recently encountered in last 2 years or 3 years, in fact, given the COVID, a lot of work from home is we forget, we didn't probably anticipate the mobility factor of users. Our products are centralized. We still believe the IAM should be centralized. We are not looking in a decentralization mode. We are not looking at cloud. We are still struggling with multi-cloud, right? How do we manage IAM in multi-cloud? Maybe it's better to have decentralized control. If a control is working in one cloud, that's fine, right? You can probably have another similar control in a different way in another cloud, but the idea is protection, right? So I think recently I've seen mobility and cloud surfacing a lot in IAM. Also, one advice is because IAM is a long-running program, right? People get very nervous when we ask for budget because it's not going to finish on time. We know that it's going to be 3 year, 5 year journey. So my suggestion is look for, I think, agility, look for small iterations, false, you know, quicker ways to add values. Maybe the privileged users are the set of users you only want to protect first. Leave the rest of the organization. Just look at your 10% of your team. If you protect your privileged users, you add maybe 80% of security in your organization. So please look at those low-hanging fruits and move in a faster pace. So over to you, Shushma.
Thank you, Pooja. So if I have to paraphrase the entire conversation that we have had, and thank you so much for your wonderful insights, it would be that first and foremost, the enterprise landscape is changing at an exponential pace as we speak. It is going through rapid digital transformation, and what it means is security is getting more and more complicated. So where do we start addressing these, you know, new set of challenges that this transformation is bringing about? Do we start with, say, network, data, endpoint? Where do we start? Because we all know, as Sandeep was also talking about, in terms of zero trust, there are different verticals that that will get addressed via zero trust. So where do we start with this? And the answer, as per the deliberation that we have had so far, would be more often than not, it would be an identity-centric approach, or how, you know, one of you had put forth, Yogini had put forth, sorry, Yogini, that it has to be identity and access management-centric approach that needs to be, you know, adopted. And while we are looking at it now, zero trust also, while we have been talking about it so much, we know that it is not just an IAM program as such, but any identity-based zero trust approach should not be treated as, it's not a project, it's not a plug and play that it will just start functioning on one day. You gave a very good analogy, Sandeep, in terms of, you know, spicy food. So it means different to different people. Similarly, it means different to different organizations also. So, but one thing is for sure, it cannot be treated as a project. It needs to be treated as a program where controls such as lifecycle management, context-based authentication, which Pooja spoke about, you know, device-based authentication, BYOD policies for the entire gamut of identities. We are talking about human, non-human, machine, across the entire spectrum of landscape. We talk about IT, OT, IoT, DevOps, multi-cloud. I mean, you name it, and we have that complexities in our landscape. So that is the second part of it. And the third part is, we also touched upon the best practices, as Deepesh was talking about. It is important to have automation, but you need to know what to automate and what not to automate. First fix your processes, as Pooja was talking about. And it is pertinent to have an identity-centric IAM roadmap in place. Until and unless we don't know what we are trying to protect, how do we go ahead with the controls that need to be there? So first, understand what is your access landscape, define your to be, and then, you know, move from having that roadmap to move from your as is to be, and that needs to be broken down into small measurable quantities or small phases wise. So that is overall a nutshell of what we have discussed so far. And I will now open up the discussion to the you know, to our audiences as well. Do we have any questions here? We'd be very happy to answer. Okay, none any so far, but I have, yeah.
Thank you, Sushmita. Thank you, panelists. Like, it was a great discussion. And like, we do not have any question, but yeah, someone has talked about blockchain. So can we have some insights on blockchain and IDEM? So if that could help.
Sure. So, sovereign identity or blockchain-based identity is something which is fast catching up. Sandeep, would you want to share your thoughts on it?
Can you please repeat your question? I didn't got that.
Yeah, blockchain-based identity or sovereign identity, which we are talking about these days, especially in terms of government sectors.
Yeah, unfortunately, I don't have experience on that. So,
but I can share something on blockchain because I was reading an article. So there is something called bring your own identity concept, which is picking up, right? So I think it's very relevant to the government sectors. For example, if a child, when he's born, he or she gets a birth certificate, right? So that's a form of assurance of his or her identity. As the person goes to school, he gets further certificates added to his her catalog. So that's another assurance, right? And then university, maybe taxing, if a person pays taxes, that's another confirmation that the person is really doing well. So if I gather all that identity information with me, and I use that for authentication, I use that to get access to certain areas in the government sector, I think that's where blockchain could really play a very, very big use case, because one, you have this chunk of data to manage, and then you are collaborating between multiple parties, right? So I'm thinking that's where the bring your identity is picking up on blockchain.
I would like to add on that, based on my little understanding on the blockchains. See, technically blockchains are database less authentication, and actually that completely changes or upgrades the security posture, because once you are not relying on database, that means that anybody cannot manipulate the data or database. And once we have a blockchain based item system, that means that whatever has been imprinted, created, that cannot be deleted by any which means, because it's technically it's completely a one chain which cannot be erased. So still the industry is in infant stage on blockchain based IDEM, but yes, it has strong promises where we have use cases like the ledger based systems and the contract management systems and different transactional based on blockchains, and their IDEM the blockchain-based item systems will be quite promising. That's my input. Thank you.
I think we just lost Harshita. Not a problem. Yep. Let's look at if we have any other questions. To implement zero trust, one of the recommendations is to generate profile-based reporting, but there would be a lot of concern from users, especially in Western countries, about constant monitoring of user behavior. How can this be managed?
So I think basically, there are a lot of Western companies are already doing user behavior, but when we do the user behavior analysis, in this case, we are getting a metadata, right? And once we have metadata, that actually get converts into some sort of tokens, and that tokens, even someone reads the system, no one understand that part, if that user behaving typically bad or good, right? So eventually the data is anonymized, no one can actually understand the data, but yes, the systems are reading the data to create some sort of tokens eventually, and this is where we need to consider this as an essential service to stop the account takeovers, or to stop the frauds, or to stop the IAM abuse. This is what I feel so far.
Yeah, thanks, Sandeep. And my two cents on that also would be, you take any of the compliances that are out there, like especially like the GDPR or the CCPA, right? And there, yes, there are compliance policies, especially referring to to profiling, to user user behavior profiling. But the answer to all of that would be consent. As long as you have recorded consent and taking appropriate permissions and recording it for a set duration of time, and also for that particular action, I think we would be safe. So that is the only way to go about it for circumventing any of the compliances requirements that will come up.
Absolutely. And just to add, Sushmita, I think like they say, zero trust is a mindset for the organizations when they're trying to implement. It's not a product which you use as plug and play. And for the question that they are profiling us, I think all of our data is already out there. So our profiles are already created. How we use it to create those trust zones and use it for us to make things more secure, I think that's what is zero trust support.
Okay. And I agree. Believe that as an enterprise, the IT policy has to actually deliberate clearly on what is the privacy portions of the users, what is the privacy aspects, and what is the user profiling which the system can do of the users, because users are ultimately employees. So when it comes to enterprise user profiling, there is a thin line. We all know that, but the IT policy should clearly define that. That's my take.
Right.
Yeah. So I think we are done with the questions as well, and it was really great to listen to you all. We have learned a lot, and really a thanks to all of you for joining this session. And I'm also thankful to our attendees for joining this session. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Have a good day.
Bye.
Bye bye. Thank you.